Welcome again to this food biotechnology course. Today I will talk about lactic acid fermentation, and the main product that I will discuss is the production of yogurt. We have a series of possibilities for lactic acid fermentation, mostly from milk, and from milk we can produce yogurt, sour milk, we can produce kefir, buttermilk can be fermented, or we can ferment vegetables also with lactic acid producing bacteria. And the examples that I will discuss are the fermentation of cabbage and the fermentation of olives. So for yogurt production, we have two specific bacterial species that are used in traditional yogurt, and this is the Streptococcus thermophilus and the Lactobacillus delbrueckii subspecies bulgaricus. A combination of these two bacterial strains gives the optimal product with acidity and with taste and aroma and remaining sugar concentration. So the process that is carried out for yogurt production is shown here. We have in the starting, this is very important, we have the standardization of milk, giving the milk a specified concentration of fat. After this standardization, we do the homogenization to have a homogeneous distribution of the particles in the milk, of the milk fat globules, which is done at 65 degrees. And after the homogenization, there is the heat treatment at 85 degrees for 30 minutes. This is very important, and I will talk about this a little later. After cooling down to 42 degrees, this milk is inoculated with the two species, Lactobacillus delbrueckii and Streptococcus thermophilus. And the fermentation is carried out either directly in the packaged food or in bigger vessels, and then it is transferred into the food package where it is sold. So after the fermentation, the yogurt has to be cooled to very low temperatures, let's say 4 degrees or even lower than 4 degrees, because this stops immediately the fermentation and the living bacteria are preserved in the yogurt. The homogenization is shown here. So we have in the milk, and this is very important, we have in the milk a very heterogeneous particle size, ranging from 1 micrometer to 15 micrometer around, with an average of about 8 micrometer. So after homogenization, the size is reduced to about 1 to 2 micrometer. And what is very important, that when the particle size is reduced, they do not flotate anymore and they do not separate from the liquid. The heat treatment, which is very important for the yogurt production, is mainly carried out for destroying the pathogens. And to have a safe product, these have to be removed completely. In addition, the enzymes that could modify the product later, they are also inactivated. And what is also important, that it's not only the pathogens that are destroyed, but also bacteria that are called thermodurics, which resist higher temperatures, for example, the pasteurization process. And they can grow during prolonged storage periods that we have with yogurt, because this is a stable product which can be stored for a long time, that these bacteria are eliminated. And of course, the proteins, the beta-lactoglobulin, the casein, is also inactivated. The denaturation of the remaining proteins in the yogurt, the beta-lactoglobulin, for example, this can form a complex with the kappa casein. And after this, it is possible to have the interaction with the disulfide bonds, or the formation of disulfide bonds, building a three-dimensional network, forming a stable gel. And this stable gel is one part of the quality of the yogurt, where we have a stable yogurt. So we have two possibilities. Either we have a liquid yogurt, which can be used for drinking, or we have a stable gel, which is eaten with a spoon, for example. Good. Fermentation is carried out at 42 degrees. This is the optimum temperature that gets some kind of equilibrium for the growth of the two bacterial strains of the Lactobacillus delbrueckii, which is a high acid producing bacteria. And if the acid is too high, the taste becomes very tart. And also the Streptococcus thermophilus, again, which grows at different temperatures, we have this balanced growth of the both strains forming a balanced product, a balanced taste in the product. The fermentation of the yogurt is very short. It takes only 4 hours, and the pH that is reached is below 4.5. This is a very safe pH because, if you remember earlier, the pathogens stop growing at the pH of 4.8. So if we go down with the pH, we get a more stable and safer product. After the fermentation, sugar can be added to have a sweet product, or fruits can be added, or fruit preparations can be added, because at the low temperature, when it is stored at 4 degrees centigrade, there is no continuing fermentation. So we have the possibility to add around 10% of sucrose, giving it a very nice balanced taste with sweetness and sourness of the product. What is very important for the yogurt is that we have live bacteria in the product. And the Codex Alimentarius, which is some kind of regulation of the WHO, the World Health Organization, and this states that we need at least 10 million living bacteria per gram in the product. If we have different strains, for example, in probiotics, it is allowed to have less than 10 million, so the minimum number that is necessary for probiotic yogurts is 1 million colony-forming units per gram. Probiotic yogurt, as it is shown here, can use different strains. It's not Lactobacillus, is not Streptococcus. We can use Lactobacillus acidophilus. There are patented strains from different companies. We can use Lactobacillus lactis and Bifidobacterium. So many of these are patented, they are protected, and they can be used in probiotic yogurts. So this presentation should give an overview of the lactic acid fermentation in milk products, showing that we get a stable product with low pH, no pathogens present, and this can be safe and stored for a prolonged period. Thank you.